Okay, so I've mentioned this to you guys, but just for some clarity on objectives, really my hope for this webinar tonight is that we would review college options for students with ID in Colorado, specifically the programs that are up and running, what we've learned from over the past few years, and I'll give you a little bit of a timeline of that as well. Then we're going to identify valuable skills for college success within those programs. What have we seen that students should really be developing and growing in prior to going to post-secondary programs? And then we'll lean into providing examples of goals and strategies to implement them during K-12. I did have somebody who submitted a question a bit early on about, oh, they had no idea that an IEP transfers over to college. I want to be very clear that it does not transfer over to college. So if that was confusing in the language at all, I do want to apologize. So this webinar is focusing on how students in K-12 can have meaningful goals and have preparation in place so that when they do get to college and they work with program staff under the structure of higher education, they'll be able to receive supports, but it will not be the same. It's not going to be an IEP that goes from K-12 to higher education. Most of the time, what we're going to see is students receiving an accommodation letter at their high school, or in these cases with inclusive higher education, we're looking at person-centered plans where they'll be able to identify necessary accommodations and modifications, but the document is very different process. So I just want to make sure that that's clear. It doesn't transfer directly. I do see a question from Rim. Does a 504 transfer to college? That's the same thing where it's really great, a great document of, you know, it shows documentation of what a student needed in K-12, what their diagnosis is. That's helpful to bring to their higher education institution, but it will not transfer directly. All the accommodations that were in place in a 504 will not naturally be granted in higher education. A lot of the times they will be, but that's just not a quick transfer over. It's just used as documentation. And then it's an interactive process at the higher education level where the student and the program staff or disability support staff will sit down with them and say, these are the accommodations that are going to be appropriate at this level. And I'll touch a bit more on that, kind of the difference from those 504s and what we're going to see with inclusive higher education. So great question. So if you guys have not been aware of IN for a little while, we are a small but powerful team of two. My executive director, Tracy Murphy, and myself as a community engagement coordinator. I just want to make sure that you guys have our contact information. We want to be a resource to you as you're doing the work that you're doing. Some of the things that I really love to do is come meet with teachers and talk with them about their concerns or some of those pushback that they experience. I love to chat with families as well. So feel free to take my contact information. I'll be sending this your way in a PowerPoint as well, but just know that we want to resource you as you're navigating these conversations with the families you serve. So IN is a nonprofit. We support colleges across the state developing inclusive higher education programs specifically for students with intellectual and developmental disabilities. And really that's for the students that don't typically get to access college. They don't meet college entry criteria. They're going through severe support needs classrooms, have pretty intensive IEPs, but really have goals and desires for their future. And so across the nation, we've seen how powerful inclusive higher education is for those students to achieve their goals and really just set the bar high for their future. So we are passionate about helping colleges see the benefit of that in our community. And within these inclusive higher education programs, we're focusing on four categories. We call these our pillars of inclusive higher education. So that's that these academic programs, or that these inclusive programs, excuse me, offer academic growth where students can fully learn and be included, that they're learning social development as well, being able to connect to their peers, career advancement, learning how to work and do jobs that they love, and then developing independence as well, really hitting on that thriving piece that we're helping students thrive and be independent in whatever that looks like for their particular goals. So IN is this nonprofit that supports those programs, but we do not provide the direct support as we are just a team of two to the students on those campuses. So I'll share with you who our programs are and what institutions those are at. But IN's goal is really to support those program staff to maintain best practice. We run a consortium, so all of those program staff meet on a monthly basis to make sure we're helping students reach goals in these four categories. And then our other role primarily is getting families and teachers just connected to this option for students so that they're being prepared prior to going to K-12. So let's talk a bit about when these options were available here in Colorado. So this is a timeline. which is maybe not the most exciting thing to see you guys, but it gets me excited to see how far we've come when it comes to disability services and inclusion in the higher education sector. So you'll see 1880s, 1970s, kind of early 1990s is when we had lots of movement with disability services and advocacy just in general, giving individuals with disabilities access to typical pathways that everybody else had. The reality is those laws that were put into place that support students in higher education with disabilities was specifically for those that already meet college entry criteria and then have a diagnosis that they can receive supports for. So there's this population, students with intellectual and developmental disabilities, that weren't able to access college because they don't meet that entry criteria. And there was kind of this drop off after college or after K-12 and wondering what happens next. So in 2008, we see across the nation this movement for inclusive higher education programs, college programs for students with IDD. And there's this national coordinating center called Think College that's been so great for resourcing states all across the nation to develop these programs. So it's in 2016 that Colorado started our first inclusive higher education programs with 3 grant programs. And then 2020 is when we saw our first graduates. And so as we stand right now, we have just over 70 students enrolled in our inclusive higher education programs this year in Colorado, which is really exciting. And we're excited to see that continue to grow. You'll see down at the bottom a couple of expansion pieces. So House Bill 22-1107 was passed just last year, which allows us to expand to a few more schools across the state. So this year, INN will be running a grant program for institutions of higher education. So community colleges or universities that say, hey, I want to offer programs for this population. We're going to be able to work with them to develop those programs and make sure that they're reaching those 4 goals. So we're really excited about where we're headed as a state. We're continuing to expand these pathways for students because we've seen such great outcomes. So what are these inclusive higher education programs? Why have they been created? So as I mentioned, they're only going to be offered at a couple universities, and I'll show you those in the next slide. But they offer an alternative acceptance criteria or admission criteria for students that don't meet college entry criteria. So they don't have to have that ACT or SAT score. They're able to have a differentiated kind of diploma or high school experience. They can go through transition and still be admitted to these programs. And then they're going to be receiving what we call a certificate. So it's a comprehensive higher education certificate, because they're going to be pursuing not a bachelor's degree or an associate's degree, but they're focused in on a particular area of study, a few key skills that they want to develop for a job goal. And really what we're looking for is serving those students with ID that need additional support, that are proving additional need. And with that, the huge difference, their additional need, is that they're able to access modifications within these programs. So students can come and receive accommodations like any other college student would from disability services. But within these inclusive higher education programs, they can also sit down with program staff and say, I've received these modifications all throughout my K-12 experience, and I require modifications in order to be fully included in these classes. They'll create a plan for each student on an individualized level and figure out what modifications they can implement at the college level, which is really exciting. It gives these students access to be able to go into the college classroom, but have the content meet their cognitive level. They're going to receive far more intensive staff support and peer mentor support throughout their program. So they can have peer mentors go with them to these classes. They're going to have staff members support them as they communicate with faculty about what their needs are, et cetera. And then they're going to be fully included in courses that align with their goal. It's all focused on that career goal. And they're going to have support in our key domains, or those pillars of inclusive higher education. So this is a picture of Vince, excuse me. He's a student I worked with at ACC. And he says, going to college is actually a really fun thing. It's like freedom. I've learned how to be independent. So he was studying theater arts and music, and he actually works as an usher at a performing arts company nearby his house, and he is loving that, just loving being around that community. Started as an internship during his program and then transitioned to full-time employment when he graduated. So he's really loved what this program has offered him. It's given him the skills to be independent in a job, to have a job that he loves, and to be connected to his community. So the four pillars that these programs are going to address, as I mentioned before, is academics, social, career, and independence. For the sake of time, I'm going to kind of blaze through what these supports look like. If you guys have any questions about them, I have more in-depth webinars or resources I can send your way. But when we're looking at the academic support, it's that students can access non-traditional admission. They get inclusive courses. So they're not just taking a special education course on a college campus. They are taking courses with neurotypical college peers. Maybe it's intro to communication. Maybe it's photojournalism, whatever is in line with their goal. They typically are taking two of those integrated inclusive courses per semester, and then they are receiving one direct instruction course from the program staff outside of that. They receive accommodations and modifications, they're pursuing a certificate, and they get to choose their area of study and are held to high standards. And that's really, we're going to be camping out quite a bit on the academic piece as we go forward, about how students can prepare for the academic challenge and growth within higher education. And then socially, they are fully included as students across campus. So they get to be a part of clubs and activities and rush fraternities, volunteer, lead. And there's a heavy support with peer mentors to go with them as natural supports in their college community and out beyond the college campus as well. All throughout these programs, students are developing career preparation skills and going through a progression of career experiences. So they're going to start with career exploration assessments, resume development, interview practice, and then they're going to move into job shadows and internships, placed paid employment on campus or off campus. And ideally, by the time that they graduate, they're focused in on a specific job that's in their area of study and either getting paid internship or paid employment in that arena. And then lastly, all of this kind of points towards it, but we're seeing students really grow in independence. So our universities have on-campus living options where they can receive supports. There's a focus on life skill development, financial management, and that's really where that one specialized course comes into place. Program staff will speak specifically to personal development, self-determination, money management, all of those skills that they really need direct instruction in. But really students are just thriving and becoming just fuller versions of who they are and seeing what they're passionate about and pursuing that at the college level. So this is what all of the programs that we support offer. And these are the four programs that are up and running here in Colorado. So the first three are the ones that started back in 2016, our first grant programs. So Elevate at Arapahoe Community College in Littleton. We've got the Office of Inclusive Services in Colorado Springs, Goal at UNC and Greeley. And all three of those programs are what we call CTP certified, which stands for Comprehensive Transition and Post-Secondary Programs. That's fancy language for the fact that they meet a long list of criteria that shows that they are fully inclusive with these students. So students are taking courses alongside their peers, they're meeting high academic standards, and they're being prepared for a meaningful job when they graduate. So that CTP status allows students within those three programs to access federal aid. So they can complete a FAFSA if they're enrolled in that program, and they can access federal grants and federal work study. Because the students are receiving a modified certificate where they're getting modifications to the curriculum, at this point, they're not able to access federal loans, but still lots of students get good support from federal grants and federal work study. So that's important that those three schools have that option. And then they also have the same comprehensive higher education certificate. So it's the same kind of layout accredited by each institution and transferable across these programs. So a student can start at ACC, like a typical college, community college student, and then transfer to UNC if they want to transition to living on campus. And their credits from that comprehensive certificate will transfer. So those are two really big things that Regis, which is here in Denver, Regis University, is working on right now. Those two things are in progress. They don't yet have CTP status and they don't yet have that certificate up and running, but they're well on their way. And the goal is that it's going to be transferable across all of these programs as we continue to expand. So those are the four that are up and running. And as I mentioned, we're looking for a few more to pop up in the next year. So a quick glance at what are our students studying? So what we love is that students have access to the full course catalog. They don't have to just choose from a select group of classes. They get to say, hey, this is an offered major here, and I'm interested in learning something in that field to help me be more employable. So we have students studying graphic design, early childhood, government, healthcare, photojournalism, sports management, really all across the board, which has been really exciting to see their preferences and their desires really come to the forefront as they pursue higher education. And then the question is, well, what does this lead to? Are we seeing outcomes for our students? As I mentioned, 2020 is when we saw our first graduates. So we're able to track, you know, what are the jobs that our students are getting? What's some of the diversity of work that they're able to receive? And these are just some great examples of the outcomes that we're seeing. We have a student who's doing social work. She's a one-on-one social worker for students with autism, and she studied at UNC. She's also doing some part-time para educating at her local school district, which has been wonderful. She's really grown in so many ways, and that was not a job she felt qualified for prior to her experiences in college. We have a student, Elnaz, who's doing administrative assistance. She loves business. She studied business at ACC, and she's in her sweet spot now. We've got students doing graphic design at local graphic design companies. Several students that are teacher assistants at preschools or like after school daycare at local districts. We have a student who studied nutrition. She's working in the nutrition department at a hospital, supporting families that come in with needs there. Students that are self-advocates, students that are teaching and interpreting for ASL, which has been really wonderful. That's Mia, that picture there. She's doing an ASL class instruction with the preschool there. Students that are working at PBS stations, athletic departments at local universities, and then also students that have become ambassadors for their inclusive higher education program. So they are there to support freshmen as they come in and kind of guide them through that process and also inform families about the programs. So really what we're seeing is that students have access to more diverse jobs than what they typically did without this experience and without this development. And we also know from our outcomes, we're seeing over 75% employment rate from our students that are graduating. And we anticipate that has been impacted by COVID and will be even higher as we round out this coming year. But at the national level, we see that students going through these programs are 3 times more likely to be employed than students that don't with ID. So, and beyond that, we see that they're fully engaged in their community. They feel like they have, or they're aware that they have a purpose and a role in their community because they've experienced this level of inclusion. And that transfers to whatever they do in their future. So it's really invaluable in that way. So I'm curious, just with the background of what our programs offer, any questions from those pieces so far?
This is Rim. I got a couple of questions.
Yeah.
All right. And so these students are, you said, are pursuing a certificate?
Correct.
Because they do have a modified curriculum.
Correct.
And
yep.
So none of the classes that they take, can those go toward an associate's in some cases?
In some cases, they can. Yes. We've had a couple of students at ACC that what will look different on their transcript. There's going to be a few courses that are identified as modified, and there'll be a separate part of their transcript that says those courses were completed to the fullest extent.
And then for certain certifications, like, for example, that ECE is intriguing because early childhood ed is a field that is wide open and they need people. Is there potential that this could lead toward an ECE certification?
Absolutely. I think when we're looking at more trade-based certifications or specific job certifications, if a student needs that type of certificate to get a job, they would have to go through those courses and that programming without any modification. So they would have some intensive support to do that. We've had that happen with the student studying CNA, so the nursing assistant certificate. She had to complete that exam without any modification in order to attain that fully. So when there's some of those specific trade certificates, they potentially take those exams a few times and get some guidance along the way, but they absolutely can't pursue that.
And y'all are actually putting in place supports to help them take that unmodified curriculum.
Mm-hmm. Yep. So they would still be able to access peer mentors going into the classes and maybe helping understand what's happening in discussion. They have lots of one-on-one support from peer mentors after classes to talk about What happened? What are you reading? How are we fully understanding this so that they can reach those expectations?
And then you said that y'all are a staff of two. So actually, the people that are providing that are provided by the universities.
Correct. Yep. So these programs are going to have, in an ideal world, they're run by four staff. There's going to be a director, an academic coordinator, a campus engagement coordinator, and an employment coordinator, all focused on serving this particular population on the campus.
And all of those people at the campuses are referred to as in-program employees?
So they're going to be underneath the title of the program at their institution. So like at UNC, their inclusive program is called GOAL.
Gotcha.
And so they're going to be GOAL employees.
What about employee, you know, the apprenticeships and internships after? Do y'all get into that any as far as opening the door for an internship or apprenticeship?
Yep, absolutely. Yeah, students, we have students, 100% of the students in these programs are having some work experience by the time that they graduate, including internships or apprenticeships. Whether that's paid or unpaid is a little bit differentiated across the schools, but all of them are having at least meaningful experiences in those areas of interest.
Okay, this is just great that this program exists. So I really appreciate y'all's work.
Absolutely, absolutely. CG, did you have a question for us?
I did. A couple, actually. Okay. One is there job placement at the end of their college career?
I would say, so that's our ideal. So once every student comes and sets up their like program plan and person-centered plan, their goal is to say, where do we want to be placed by the time that you graduate? What we've seen recently is that that's not always the case. There's some difficulty with DVR support in the area that they go back to if they're moving back home, things like that. So it's not 100% across the board, but that is absolutely the goal, that they're placed in a job and have, you know, all the skills that they need to continue in that job and maintain it as they transition out.
Okay, good. And then the other one is, I know there's an interview process at the beginning. Could you just speak a little bit about that?
Absolutely. Yes. Great question. So applications open up in the winter time, springtime, and they only accept new cohorts in the fall. So students are never going to start mid-year, and they're always going to start in the fall. So applications are open right now. And when students are interested in applying, all of the schools have, you know, little nuanced components of their application, but for the most part, they're all looking for, they're going to have a questionnaire for the students to fill out to say why they want to go to college, what they want to study, why they think it's a good fit for them. They're going to have to submit documentation of their diagnosis. So that could be medical documentation that shows their diagnosis and background. It could also be an extensive IEP that has a diagnosis identified on there. Like I said, they're looking for really serving students with intellectual or developmental disabilities, but there are gray areas within that diagnosis, and we know that. So we have several students on the autism spectrum disorder, several students with other health impairments, but in their IEP, you can see that there's evidence of a need for modification and cognitive support in that way. So they're going to be looking for IEP, like a pretty robust IEP, transition IEP, or the senior year of one. And then they're also going to ask for parent and educator questionnaires or letters of recommendation. So from the parent perspective, are they going to be able to support this transition for the student? Do they see their strengths and their weaknesses? How is that going to play out? And then from the educator perspective, do they recommend this student to pursue for their education? So that's just the application process. And then they bring you in for a full, typically a half day on campus, where there's a quick interview with the program staff, really just for students to be able to share more about why they want to go to college. I think what we have found is with the higher expectations and the higher standards students experience at the college level, there's a high need for intrinsic motivation, something that's really motivating the student to pursue this. And so that's really what they're looking for in those interviews. And then they'll also take time to interview parents most of the time to just get a gauge for their support as well. And then oftentimes they get to observe a college class so they can kind of see a lay of the land and really figure out if they feel comfortable on that campus. So that tends to be the whole application process. And then they make announcements here at the end of spring about who's accepted. Does that answer your question?
It does. I've heard, you know, I think that seems to be a scary part for the applicants.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Yeah, it can feel really daunting to have to do all of those pieces. I think what we want to communicate to families and to students is they're not looking for, you know, this like perfect portfolio or all these accomplishments that they need to have before college. It's really understanding that these students want to be there. That's really such a top-notch criteria that they show that motivation and desire.
I just, it's nervous. It makes them nervous. That's why.
I understand that. I understand that. All righty. Well, if we don't have any more questions about that, I'm going to dive into some of these skills that we're seeing being really valuable for this.
I do have a couple more questions if you're okay.
Go for it.
All right. Can you speak to a little bit about the financing of it?
Yeah.
So you spoke about grants or something?
Mm-hmm. Yep. So students, you know, this is a higher education program, so they're going to be expected to pay for it on their own. It's not going to come from a district or anything like that. But there are several ways to chip away at the costs for students pursuing this particular route. So because a lot of our families with students with ID have not prepared financially for these options many years ago. And so that kind of comes to when they graduate and it's right in their face and those numbers seem really daunting. So students at these programs, they're going to pay the same cost per credit hour. So as I mentioned, they're only taking two inclusive courses per semester. So they're taking between 6 to 9 credits each semester. So that's a far lower level of credits than most full, full hours college students. So they're going to pay just for whichever credits they're receiving. So 6 to 9, that could range from 200 per credit hour at an institution to 500 per credit hour. So it's different at each institution. But that's one of the main fees, is that they're paying for those credits. And then they're also going to pay a program fee. So this is the fee that goes to the program staff to support them in all of these ways. At the community college level, that's about closer to $3,000 annually. At the university level, that can be upwards of $8,000 annually. And they're all different in their numbers. So that can really tack on after a while and can be really daunting for families. So we encourage them to all be connected with Division of Vocational Rehabilitation. DVR counselors can sit down with these students, identify their career goal, and if they select that area of study at the institution, DVR can help pay for a portion of tuition. We also want to encourage them to be connected with their community-centered boards. Some of them offer scholarships on a regular basis or can offer what they call self-determination funds to help promote some of this pursuit of inclusive higher education. And then there's also lots of national scholarships that we connect students to. So Think College is that national resource hub for all inclusive higher education, and they have a robust list of different scholarships. Some of those are going to be disability specific scholarships. So Ruby's Rainbows is a really popular one for students with Down syndrome, but they also have additional scholarships that students can pursue if it's not a diagnosis specific. So we encourage students to go that route as well. So those are kind of the top ones that really help chip away at the cost. And then some of our programs offer scholarships as well. So our program staff look for grant funding a lot to be able to offer scholarships to students that need that to make it more accessible to our students that are coming from, you know, low socioeconomic backgrounds or just under-resourced. So Rim, I know that's probably a lot of information. I have one whole handout. I'll make sure to include that in our email for you guys.
Okay, and then does it have an in-person requirement or is there a remote option?
So right now they're all in person. Yeah, just because the supports are so robust and we really see the value of those students being amongst their peers. As of now, they're all in person.
And so I heard your intro about trying to expand the program. So right now it's not statewide as far as in the community college system yet?
So it's just at one community college. Yeah, we're looking to expand to some other ones. Yeah.
All right. Very good. Thank you.
Yeah. Yeah. And Neil, I see your question. Let's see, start preparing for college and all these considerations, such as funding. So really, as we move forward, I'm going to be talking about skill development for students, not necessarily financial preparation for these programs. So what I will do, I will make sure to send you guys my handout for that financial preparation guidance. And there's also a webinar we have that was geared towards ways to save for higher education in these particular programs. So I'll make sure to resource you all with that when I send the recording of this webinar. Wonderful. Okay, well, I will just, I think we kind of all have the same tone, the importance of preparing students for post-secondary success, which I love, but I love to present just a reminder of why it's important. And maybe CG, this speaks to some of that pushback you'll experience from teachers, but why is it important to prepare them with these skills that we see as post-secondary readiness skills? The first reason that I provide to families and to teachers is that we want to consider normative pathways. So meaning, what is the typical path that any student at, you know, age 18 is experiencing? Typically, all of their teachers are asking them, what do you want to do after high school? What college do you want to go to? What are you considering next? And a lot of times we don't see that happening for our students with more severe disabilities. And so we want to provide the same pathway that any other student in their age group would experience. So having those conversations, allowing them to dream and think about those things, because now it really is an option. So a normative pathway is really important for us. That's kind of the frame of reference we have for all of the programming at our institutions as well. Then we also want to provide informed choice. So a lot of times I'll see teachers that say, well, I don't want to provide this option for my students because I don't think they'll be successful. They're kind of making their own perceptions and limiting that information from that family or that student based on their perceptions. And I don't fault them for that necessarily. I understand where they're coming from, but we want to say that the student has the choice to say, we want them to know, oh, that sounds really hard and I'm not interested in that, and to make their own decision to take themselves out of that process. But we don't want to completely eliminate that option from them just because we perceive that they won't be able to pursue it. So we want them to have that informed choice where they can say, yes, I want to find out more or grow in skills to be ready for that down the line, or no, thank you, that's not something that I have as my post-secondary goal. And all of that is really couched in what I call the even if mentality. So even if students don't want to go to inclusive higher education, even if they don't have this big dream for their job, focusing on the skills that we're going to be talking about is going to set them up for success no matter what they do. It's going to help them with self-determination, self-advocacy, ownership of their skills, ways to communicate that to their community. So it really benefits them no matter if college is on the horizon for them or not. So, and that really comes down to these skills are very transferable across anything that they do. And that's important when we're talking with teachers that say, hey, this is going to take a lot of effort to develop. It is, and that is true, but these skills are going to help them long-term in their future. And there is several studies out there that talk about the link between student goals and the dreams that they have for themselves being linked with what their teachers have communicated to them about their expectations. So there, if we have teachers that say, I do believe that you can achieve these high goals, or I know that you can grow in these ways, then students' goals are going to reflect that and be more high achieving goals. So high expectations then lead to positive transition outcomes. So this is a graduate parent that we've been able to hear from her story. She says the bar has been set high and the students have risen and reached it. They have been presumed competent and their lives changed. So her student is Noah there on the right with his thumbs up. And she has seen just the power of high expectation for her students and for students just like him. So this is really the narrative. When we're developing these skills, we're talking about the importance of preparing for post-secondary success. It's all held within the reason that students deserve this option. We want them to have that normative pathway, have informed choice, and be able to really dream about their futures just like any other student their age. So I do want to link this to CDE's sequencing of services work right now. I'm sure some of you have heard of this. Hopefully all of you have heard of this, but this is just work across the district to help with transition outcomes and make sure that we're really readying students for a meaningful future when they graduate high school. So all of the six student core outcomes that these schools are focusing on are self-determination, navigating the community, understanding post-secondary options, having digital literacy, preparing for competitive employment, and having a disability and health management or health awareness. So all of these are being emphasized in our districts right now, and all of them are also preparing them for post-secondary success. So you're going to see lots of transferability of this language as I go throughout the rest of our skills. there's a link to the SOS work that's happening. So when I send this your way, I encourage you guys to check that out. It's really great work about collaborating with the different agencies and making sure we're really supporting students with disabilities as they go out into their world. So now we're going to dig in. What are some of the skills that we've really seen as essential for these students in inclusive higher education programs? And I'm going to hit on all of those domains. So academics, career, independence, and social. So I'm going to speak to a couple of the skills and then some of the preparation strategies I recommend at the secondary level. So one of the top ones that we see is a need for attendance and punctuality. So something that's really helpful in K-12 classrooms and SSN classrooms is to help students identify a calendar app so that they can track reminders. And then having time set in place each day where they're recording appointments or reminders in their calendar. So stopping 5 minutes before lunch and say, hey, does everybody have this next thing in their calendar app? Just kind of instilling that pausing and adding to a calendar is going to be really good for their development. And also including margin time. So we see some students that are coming to college and they start signing up for everything because they have the freedom of their schedule and they're running from class to club to tutoring to all of these things. And so really helping them understand the importance of margin in between the appointments that they put on their calendar is a good benefit as well. So then we see that students really need to have access and confidence to use resources across the college campuses. So that's something that's really pushed in these programs, that they don't just come to the program staff for every single question they have, but that they would consider, what are the resources already available to me as a student on this campus, just like anybody else? And how are they going to go access those? So things like going to an information desk if they don't know where their classroom is supposed to be. Just going to that front desk and saying, hey, I know I'm supposed to be in this class. Where would I find it? Going to the library, accessing counseling, things like that. So just helping students in special education during K-12 to know that the supports across their high school campus are available to them too, because that's what they're going to experience at this college level. There's a huge emphasis on knowing how to use technology. No matter what classes they take, there's going to be a need for them to access pretty common technology software. So a lot of times we're looking at office software, so Word and Excel, things like that. So just having students practice that if they do, you know, a little writing prompt during class. Make sure they're doing that in Microsoft, typing it on a computer. That's really helpful. Helping them complete regularly scheduled email checks in class is so helpful because then it's not as daunting when they get to college. So much of the primary communication stream is through emails at the college level. So really instilling that regular check-in on their email is going to be huge. And then taking some time to look at common learning management systems. So these are things like Canvas or Blackboard, where students will be submitting assignments at the college level, looking at lectures, looking at all of their syllabi, all of those things. So just simply, you know, researching those so that they can see what that looks like and how they can click around that would be really helpful. It just causes it to not be as daunting once they get there. Assistive technology is going to be a really powerful tool for students at the college level. So we encourage students in K-12 for their teachers to promote the use of audiobooks or even Google, which has a dictation option. So students can dictate a paragraph instead of having to type it all up. So just using some of those systems as regular practices in class can be really helpful for them. I have commonly come across students that by the time they get to their senior year or they're in 18 to 21 programs, they are doing very little reading or writing. And then they get to college and they're a little jolted by the expectations of these college courses. Even with modifications, like I said, we're holding them to high standards. So we want them to be reading their textbooks. We want them to be engaging in writing a summary or something along those lines. So it's really important that these basic reading and writing skills continue on throughout their entire K-12 experience. So some of the big things that we see with writing is just maintaining some sentence structure and paragraph structure. So even if that's providing a graphic organizer for how to guide a paragraph, that's great. Just giving some key guides for them to maintain that structure in their mind all the way through their K-12. And another component is just maintaining proper email etiquette. So, you know, I remember back in the day, we would learn the structure of how to write a letter. Well, now the emphasis is really how to write an email. What's your intro? How do you close it out? And really helping them understand the essential components of emailing. That's a great use of basic writing skills and to continue that during their K-12 programming. For reading, a lot of what we see is students just needing to pull out key information from textbooks. So teaching them things like reading the headlines or the headings, understanding how to find chapter outlines in a textbook, and then really helping them understand the power of annotation. So whether that's, you know, circling something that stands out to them, highlighting vocabulary words, that kind of practice seems to be lost a lot in our SSN classrooms, and we want to bring that back because that's going to help them a ton at the college level. But also, we consider how this helps them at the post-college level. If they're starting a new job and they have a handbook they need to go through, how are they going to pull out those key concepts and making sure that they understand those expectations? So annotation is really big. And then using time in class to have students read some college readiness websites. That's a great way to continue their reading comprehension and link it to their post-secondary goals. So I put two options on that one. ThinkCollege.net is a national coordinating hub, and then I'mDetermined.org is a really wonderful website as well for students to click through, to read through, and they have some engaging activities on there as well. And then we really want students to know their learning style. So at the K-12 level, a lot of times what we see is students have these IEPs or these 504s, and they're kind of disseminated to their teachers, and the students don't really have to do the work of communicating their learning needs to their professors or to their teachers. And so at the college level, even with the support they get from our program staff, they're empowered to meet with their professors to say, this is my list of accommodations and modifications. Here's what I really need in this class. How is this going to work? How are we going to work together? What are the expectations? So helping them understand what their approved accommodations are and modifications are in the K-12 system is going to help them communicate that clearly when they get to college. And just helping them understand what are some of those learning styles. There are great websites or quizzes they can take to see, are they auditory? Do they like having tactile experiences? Just encouraging them to assess the way that they learn and teaching them how to communicate that with those around them. A big recommendation I have is helping students, especially in SSN classrooms, to meet one-on-one with their paraeducators and communicate their accommodations or modifications. Because a lot of times, paraeducators or supports within this class will just do those things for them without having the student communicate it first. So just at the beginning of a semester, having students sit down with paraeducators, kind of like speed dating if you need to, right? Have the paraeducators walk around to each student and have the student communicate what they're going to be needing from those supports in the classroom is really big. And then we encourage students to explore their academic interests. So this kind of goes back to that desire to have students dream and pursue things that they're interested in. And so we want them to dream up what are some of their things that they want to learn about in the future. So help them to identify, find, and register for events or activities in the community that help them learn. There's also just a really good three-step process that we encourage students to go through when they're curious about something. So it's writing down what they know about that topic, what they want to know about that topic, and then after they've pursued it, what they've learned about that topic. So just the know, want, learn method is really, really great as well. A few more academics skills that we've seen are really valuable. Students are going to be following syllabi at the college level. I think that sometimes gets lost in the high school chaos and all the things that are being navigated in special education realms. And so while maybe a syllabus isn't going to be practical for most special educators, we do encourage unit outlines. If you're going to have a specific unit you're going through, write up an outline so that students have the practice of going back to that outline, knowing what's coming, being able to focus on what's coming up next. And then refer to that consistently or refer to a schedule of assignments often so that there's that reference that they can always have. Because at the college level, we can think back to how many times our professors said, well, it's in the syllabus. So that's still true for these students. They're going to hear that from their professors. Well, it's in the syllabus. So we want them to have that practice of going back to those documents of support. Note-taking, even if students have a range of abilities or disabilities, we think that practice with note-taking or systems of note-taking is going to be really helpful. That's going to do a couple of things. It's going to keep them engaged in class discussions, but it's also going to teach them to pay attention to those key concepts. So something that we see is really helpful is just note-taking templates. Just giving students note-taking templates during their days at the K-12 level so that they can practice pulling out those key topics and key information. Help them determine the best type of note-taking system for them. So some students are going to prefer to type. Some students are going to prefer to take it in a spiral notebook. Or some students, based on their needs, might have a recording device. How are they going to store those things? So just talking through how they want to store information that they're learning in high school, because that will transfer over to their college experience. Study skills are also really big. Students, it is uncommon for them to have to do real studying during high school a lot of the times, especially those that are not fully included in most courses. So we want to help them identify the importance of reviewing information. That's going to help them on a quiz and an exam, yes, but also it's going to help ingrain that information in their long-term memory so that they can use it in employment or they can use it in the community. So a really common study tactic at the college level is using Quizlet. So if teachers can use Quizlet.com where they create flashcards, it's electronic flashcards for students to access on their own. That's a really great process and students can do that really well at the college level as well. And then a big study strategy that we've helped with students at the college level is helping them reteach information to their peers. So just rereading notes is kind of like passive studying. But having to restate something in your own words to somebody that you know causes some real, it requires you to ingrain that information in your long-term memory and really understand it more deeply. So having things like think, pair, share options in the classroom where you're teaching content and then you pause and you have students think about their response to that, pair up with somebody close by, and then reteach it, share it out in their own words. That's going to help them understand the importance of review and study and being able to reteach information. Lots of these students are now going to be participating in class discussions at the college level. And so there's some guidance that's going to be needed from, you know, the program staff are going to guide when they're at college. But prior to that, helping students stay on topic, developing some strategies to communicate if they're on or off topic, if there's a class discussion, prompting students to ask questions and checking for understanding, not just passively listening, but asking questions about information in the class, the content that's being presented. And then really help them engage with appropriate levels. So that we oftentimes have students that are oversharers and helping them navigate how do we share space with other students in the classroom or students that don't share at all. So prompting them to think of one thing to add to the discussion and share that out in a meaningful way is great. So really just incorporating some of those discussion strategies into the K-12 classroom is going to help them feel prepared for the discussions in the future. And then there's a requirement to prepare before classes at the college level. So what we do with a lot of our students is they meet with a peer mentor before they go to their class. So they're going to sit down and do a preview and review session. So they're going to review some of their notes from the last class. So say they're going to intro to communication. Let's review what that chapter was about. Let's go to that chapter outline and just jog our memories about that. Let's talk about what do we think we might be discussing in class today? What are some questions we might have? Just engaging in that learning process before they even get to the class. And then sometimes they do that after class as well, where they review directly after. What are your notes? What were those key ideas that you heard? So something that can be helpful at the K-12 level is prompting students to follow a preparation checklist. So maybe before you start a unit, you have a checklist on the whiteboard that you're going to have these readings due, notes are going to be due, here's assignments, make sure you ask questions and think about some possible discussions and just constantly reflect back to that. Do you have your readings with you? Do you have textbooks with you? Do you have your notes from last week's class with you? Did you bring your assignment with you? And helping them to process through every time before I go in to learn, I want to be prepared in advance. I don't want to go in cold. Communication with instructors is a big curveball for our students. And what we have loved seeing from our college level instructors, they started with these programs being really concerned about having students with ID in their classroom. I've heard several teachers say things along the lines of, I was nervous that they would cause disruption. And now that they've been able to work with these students, they say that they actually caused depth, of discussion, depth of vulnerability and honesty in their classroom. And so there's such an admiration for these students that are coming from this program into these college classrooms. And they're going to really require one-on-one communication with those students. They really value them. They see them as any other student in that class. So they're going to set up meetings with them, talk about assignments with them. So it's really important for students to be able to communicate clearly with their professors. So something that could be helpful is scheduling one-on-one meetings with students, with all of their high school teachers and paraeducators, like I mentioned, and sharing what their needs are in those classes, talking about what expectations are. And then also practicing early communication about absences, tardiness, any questions they have about assignments, not just waiting to get there the next day, but practice if you know of an absence or if you know of a question coming up, sending an email to that teacher right then and there so that you have that ongoing communication. And then a big piece that we see is focusing in on quality of work. So a lot of times our students coming from the special education classroom are not trained necessarily, but kind of stuck in this mentality of filling out worksheets really, really quickly and sending it in without taking time to pause and to reflect on the work that they've done. And a lot of times that's because they don't know the meaning behind that work. And so that's really big for us, is to share with students that there's purpose behind every assignment that we do. But something that we really encourage them to do is to pause before they submit assignments and to use proofreading techniques. So Grammarly is a great one that'll do it for you. But oftentimes reading it aloud to a friend of yours is going to be really helpful to really review and hear what you sound like. And then also looking back on that assignment rubric. What were the expectations of the assignment? And these students with modified expectations will have a modified rubric, but looking back and saying, what was I supposed to do? And then looking at their finished product, did I do it? That's so great for the college environment, but we can also attest that's so great for the work environment, making sure that they're taking care and taking the time to do quality work. That's something that they get lots of support in with peer mentors, but we'd love to see them practice that early on as well. So those are all the academic skills that we really see an emphasis in and encourage students to work on. Do you guys have any questions about those pieces or recommendations at all?
I think they're very helpful. Are you going to send us the slideshow?
Okay. Yep, I will. You'll get it in a PowerPoint and a PDF. So absolutely. Awesome. Okay, well, I'm going to jump into our social and community skills as well. So as I said, we're going to go through those domains. So for our social domain, things that we're seeing students need to grow in is understanding professional relationships and just the difference between a student relationship or a peer relationship and a professional relationship. So talking through varying levels of relationships and what expectations there are, what kind of language you would have in an email communication to a professor versus a peer is just really great for them to start processing through early on. Developing some conflict resolution. So giving guidelines, there's often like a 5-step guide to conflict resolution. Thinking through those 5 steps is really helpful, and doing that within a supported environment at the K-12 level is great. Planning and gathering and outings has been something that we didn't realize was going to be a high need for these students. They're now experiencing some independence. They have downtime in their schedule. They're only taking 2 classes a semester, so they have these gaps of time and they're wanting to go to Chick-fil-A. So we've seen professors and staff members have to sit down with these students to help them understand the components of planning an outing. It's not just showing up at Chick-fil-A, but now they have to consider, how much money do they have? Is everybody free at the same time? Does everybody have a ride to go there? So they really help them with some of those like checklists of planning a gathering with their friends. And what's cool is we're seeing that transfer when they graduate. We now have several graduates from the Denver metro area that are gathering on their own, and parents get to have, you know, hands off and see these students really run with it and implement those things well. really important to have adaptability. So, you know, a lot of times at K-12, we have these structured days. They know where they're going to be all the time. Like I said, at the college level, their schedule is a little bit more lax. And so having some adaptability and a flexible perspective is really going to set them up for success. So a way to practice that early on is creating a classroom culture of choice. So giving some choices for students to not always have to do the same rigid thing, but give some option. Encourage curiosity and helping them find answers independently. And then really allowing for natural consequences. So this is probably one of the scariest ones that we talk about with families and teachers is, well, if a student, let's say they choose to not go to one of their classes, if they're supposed to be in an English class at the high school level, they choose to not go there. And typically maybe a paraeducator will try to track them down, bring them back, all these things. But what if they don't? What if that student has to bear the consequences of skipping an entire class and navigating what that looks like and learning how to change and grow and be adaptable from those experiences? We also encourage responsible risk-taking. So these program staff are not going to be with students 24/7. There's going to be levels of independence that they're going to need to have and time that they get to be a young adult. Ask questions, pursue things that they're interested in. And so developing a criteria for what's a responsible risk to take and what's an irresponsible risk to take is really good because we want them to have security and safety in mind for sure. But just knowing that at the college level, they have space to have that curiosity to take those risks as needed. So support in how to make those decisions is going to be great on the front end. Use of resources, you saw this one under academics. It's also really helpful at the community level, being able to go to information desks, call centers if they have questions, and just thinking through what are some natural ways that they can get their questions answered. Use of amenities, so going to the gym, the library, the counseling center, that has all been really huge for students, knowing that they have access to those types of supports on campus. So talking about healthy habits, ways to use their time wisely, resources in their community that they can go to, like a rec center, would be really wonderful. And then participation in clubs. So that has been really a common favorite part of college for a lot of our students is that they're engaging in these clubs they never thought they could. And so helping them at the K-12 level, think about what clubs are available across our campus and how can we work on having you included in those, not just a special education club, but any club. And how are you going to be advocating for yourself and getting support in that and helping them do some of that research on the front end. Under our career domain, and as I mentioned, these are all going to be very transferable. It's really important for students to have career awareness. So this is where they're looking at the variety of jobs under each pathway. So, you know, sometimes students only think about teaching or trades, but there's a really wonderful website called ONET Online where they can search up teaching and see 50 plus types of jobs underneath that one category. So really helping students understand the types of jobs that are available to them, doing some of that digging is really wonderful. Doing some job shadows or informational interviews where they're calling people to see what a day in the life of their job looks like. Having self-awareness, meaning that they have an awareness of what they're passionate about and interested in and what their capabilities are, what their strengths are, and what their growth points are. Because sometimes if we have a student who thinks they want to be a teacher, but really doesn't have a good strength of patience, we can talk about, well, hey, that job is going to require lots of patience. Is that something you want to work on to get there? Or do we want to look at a different job pursuit, right? So talking through those levels of self-awareness and how they impact their job goal is going to be really big. Self-advocacy, understanding the types of needed supports they're going to have on the job. And then a great practice is to have them role play asking for those types of supports. So if that's assistive technology, if that's, you know, somebody to support them in communicating with a client, whatever it is, role playing asking for supports in different scenarios is going to be great. Problem solving is huge. We're all learning that. And so much of that learning happens at the college level. But prior to helping students follow a problem solving process chart, so that's similar to that critical thinking where there's five steps to think through. Something that I see is really helpful in the classrooms is following an I do, we do, you do process. So this is kind of like a fading of support process where the teacher will present how to do something, then they do it together, and then they allow the student to do it on their own with very little prompting to see how that goes, how they're able to problem solve on their own. That's a really good just practice to have in instruction. Persistence is really big, so helping students learn from their mistakes, identifying what motivates them to keep going is going to be really important. Taking initiative, so this has been really big for that downtime, but helping them consider how this is going to be important for their careers and their job experiences. So having like a menu in the classroom of meaningful tasks to do during downtime. If you have that 15-minute gap before lunch comes, what's something you can do that's productive and helpful? And then helping them create task lists. So maybe that's the start of your class. Every single time you start a class, you say, hey, let's all write down what are the top three tasks we have to do today. So that when we have some time, we can look back and make sure that we're following up on those. Anticipating needs. So helping students to identify where they might experience more challenges, what types of work might cause more challenge, and encouraging them to be proactive in some of the coping skills for that. And then taking responsibility, making sure that they are the ones taking responsibility for their daily and weekly schedule, that they're waking up to alarms, that they're really taking ownership of the day-to-day tasks of their life. That's going to help them in their career domain as well. And then finally, in the independence domain, a big component is navigating campus. So no longer are students just coming to one classroom and having a paraeducator walk with them from class to class. They are taking classes all across the campus, and they're going to be navigating how to take transportation or maybe a shuttle on campus or walk or ride a bike. So really helping FADE supports for students with navigating from class to class or going to lunch is going to be so pivotal for them to feel confident and competent navigating different areas across a college campus. I also think it's really important for students to see college campuses early on and just to see, you know, how long does it take you to get from the lunchroom to the academic classrooms? That use of downtime, again, helping students brainstorm what are productive activities for downtime. Having self-awareness and personal regulation. So something that we think is helpful for students is to kind of have what we call like a back pocket list of coping skills. So just something they can pull out of their back pocket of these are the three things that really help me focus, calm down, whatever it might be, where they have some of that self-awareness and that personal regulation in place so that when they go to a new environment, it's not as daunting. Self-care and cleanliness. So this is something that mainly takes place at home and is not much of a K-12 emphasis, but even things like helping students practice cleaning in the classroom is really great, where they see the value of making sure that we're taking trash out, things like that, because that's going to help them with dorm living if that's an option for them. Traveling across the community. So a big component is helping students understand, especially for a commuter school, which is Arapahoe Community College, helping them understand how to take access a ride or use public transportation or utilize a system like Uber safely. Talking through some of those options with students is a really great method to prepare them for whatever they do post K-12. Having interagency connections. So we really want students to be connected to DVR. We want them to be connected to their CCBs. So starting those conversations now is great. The benefit of these programs is those program staff are great advocates between those agencies and supporting students in their communication. But when they have those communications earlier on before they start at the college level, it's a smoother process for sure. Students grow in self-determination, and so helping students at the high school level just determine what their goals are and then not stopping there, but backtracking a bit and saying, what are the steps that we need to reach to get to that goal? A lot of times we do that in the IEP meetings, but we don't prompt students to do that. So if they have a goal, helping them identify what are the small steps along the way to get there, that'll kind of give them that motivation as they keep on moving through. A helpful tip is using a graphic organizer for students to do that goal setting. And I have an example of one in a few slides. And then having growth mindset. So those high standards, lots of newness and challenges and growth at the college level, helping students see that they can learn from experiences and that failure is failing forward, that we learn from those things and we can continue to grow and pursue what we want in our future. So that's just kind of a conceptual thing to bring up for our students in K-12. So really quickly, I'm going to kind of blaze through some ideas for how to set these goals in a K-12 IEP. I have in a couple of slides some really robust resources that give explicit goal writing recommendations. They have tons of helpful resources. Those are primarily from Think College. So I'm going to let them do a bulk of the IEP goal support. But I will speak a little bit when you're talking with IEP teams or writing up an IEP, the importance of having meaningful annual goals that are supported by a progressive benchmark goal. So annual goals are obviously the ones that we're going to be updating on an annual basis for these students, but it's important, especially after they hit that age 14, if not earlier, but especially at that transition point, that annual goals are based upon their post-secondary goals. So if they do have a post-secondary goal to go to college, then that means we should have academic goals continuing on throughout their K-12, right? So allowing them to focus on a post-secondary goal first, and then having that dictate and guide annual goals in the four domains. So if they desire to go to post-secondary higher education, making sure we're hitting on goals in academics, social engagement, career advancement, and independence. And there might be more outside of that arena, but for the sake of this webinar, that's what we're focusing on. So some examples of annual goals in those domains are that by the end of the school year, a student will develop reading comprehension skills by implementing annotation strategies. So it's kind of vague. We want them to develop this academic skill set that we know they'll need at the college level. And then there's going to be some benchmark goals that we hit that are specific to how they're going to do that. But then for the social component, that they would initiate participation in 1 to 3 community events. For career, that they would determine 1 to 3 career interests based on the research that they're doing. For independence, that they would start to fade support and navigate their classes, going to class and lunch independently. So those are some of those broader picture goals in those four domains. And then we want to take those and break it down into smaller measurable goals. Into what we call benchmark goals. So when benchmark goals are being created, it's kind of this funnel, right? We want to start with that post-secondary goal, move into that annual goal, and then create benchmark goals from there. And we want these benchmark goals to be more, they're tracking progress. So we want them to be measurable, something that you can track throughout a semester. And so it's important to include the ABCs, which is just audience. So who are we talking about? The student. Oftentimes, what is the context of the goal? What's the behavior? What's that strategy we really want them to develop? And what are the conditions? Is there a time frame to it? Is there a degree to it? So these are some examples from those annual goals. How can we break that into a smaller chunk? So for academics, we want the student to practice annotation and show some reading comprehension. So for 75% of her readings, she's going to submit photos of her annotations on a page, showing highlights, margin notes, whatever it might be. By a certain time, maybe the student will identify 2 to 5 community clubs that they're interested in, that they've researched, that they've looked into, and that's the start of them initiating participation. For their career, they're going to document 2 appointments with a career counselor. So note that these goals are not all housed within the special education classroom. We want these to be incorporating students and staff and programs from across the campus. And then for their independence benchmark, students are going to travel to classes with a peer mentor support instead of a staff support for 90% of the classes. That's a good starting point, and eventually fading that back to being even more independent, where eventually it's not going to be a peer, but it's going to be totally on their own. So real quick, I just want to speak to what are the strategies when we're talking about these goals. So we can have these big goals, but if we are only implementing them in a secluded type of environment, like a special education classroom, and not considering how to use the wider campus, how to use holistic K-12 supports, then we're really stifling the type of growth that these students can have in these goals. So I just present this as encouragement for goal implementation, to start with presuming competence. So really working to help students achieve the most inclusive version of that goal possible. And really starting with that at the forefront of our goal assessment and goal writing for students. So promoting high expectations for the student, but also in your classroom support. So if you have paraeducators, it's really important for all of them to be on the same team to say, we're going to hold these students to high standards. I'm not just going to fill in the blank of a word for the student. I'm going to wait for them to communicate that to me or ask for support. So making sure that high expectations are communicated for all support members of the IEP team. A use of coordinated support. So that means, you know, if there's a goal for career advancement and understanding career options, then coordinating the student to meet with a DVR counselor. And that's how they reach that goal, where they're researching career jobs with a DVR or SWAP counselor. And then really creatively using inclusive settings. So not just doing all of these goals in the SSN classroom, but considering how you can do them out in a typical club, in the library, and just inclusive settings across the campus. So this is an image from Think College of the process of goal setting at their inclusive higher education program. So students provide input, identify their skills, then they move to communicating with mentors and coaches and program staff, and then all collectively determining the skills that the student wants to work on. Then they're going to continually check in with the student, make sure that they're reporting back on how they're doing, and then revise as needed. So it's very student-led. It's collaborative that peer mentors and staff members are a part of this, and that students are really guiding the level of their goal attainment. So this is one of those examples that I had mentioned before that I would encourage educators to use, just a simplified way for students to write up like a who I am, to communicate their strengths, to communicate their goals. So really having a high level of student involvement. We want to make sure that students are continuously asked about their post-secondary goals. They can change, as most of ours do, right? Lots of students change their major. So even at the K-12 level, just checking in, like, do you still want to do that? Why not? What do we need to do to get to that goal? Helping students lead their IEPs and write their goals and have them really have a voice in that is big. And then use of strength-based transition assessments where students can feel empowered in their strengths and that's going to lead them to their decision of post-secondary goals. And then really offering student choice. So things like this person-centered planning profile where students can say, this is who I am and this is what I want to do. And they can communicate that to a variety of people across campus. That's going to help with the independence. It's going to help with self-determination and advocacy. And so I have that linked as well on this page where you guys can jump to that document and see some of the other resources to help with student involvement in the goal attainment process. And this I'll quickly say, as you're assessing goals or as educators are assessing goals, we just encourage a variety of assessment. It doesn't have to all be formal assessment. Sometimes those formal assessments are taken and collecting dust on bookshelves. So we consider lots of things like task analysis, observing somebody, observing students in a class, taking a look at grades and assignments and grading them critically to show how they're actually growing and learning. And then having some self-reporting, allowing students to share how they're doing on that goal. And then also natural supports, being able to present some self-reporting too, or some reporting for the student. So teachers, this is what we do for the IEP. We ask them how it's going, how they're doing on these goals, but also asking peer mentors in their classroom or asking any student aides or paraeducators how they see these students reaching these goals. So just thinking creatively about how we can assess them, because the students are more than just those formal assessments in a formal survey. Okay, lots of information for you guys. And as I mentioned, I'm going to send this all to you, but I'm curious what questions have popped up as we've continued forward. Awesome. Well, this is a picture of students from UNC. They're all in a dorm room about the Head to Community event. But I do just want to, as closing remarks, for all of you who are in various roles within the education system, as I mentioned, it can feel daunting to think about how to prepare students with, you know, ID for this level of independence. just want to encourage you that you're not alone. I want to encourage the teachers that you work with that they're not alone. It is worthwhile work, but there are supports available. Some of my favorite things are just talking with teachers on the phone and helping them strategize how to implement this in their classroom. So just an encouragement to you that this work is worthwhile and that there's teams of people that want to support it. And an encouragement to collaborate with community agencies. I think the more that we can get that collaboration going in the K-12 system, the better it's going to be when students graduate. And it helps to share the load of this type of development and goal attainment. And then I talk a lot with teachers about not taking on all of those skills at once, right? There's lots of skills to continuously be developing, but to really be specific on what's an attainable skill for my students right now. What's the next thing that I need them to be working on, and really have a progressive view of goal setting and development that kind of helps to make it more attainable and manageable as we move forward. So, as I mentioned, there's going to be lots of resources on here. So there's some resources to just in information, the webinars we're going to continue doing, newsletters, things like that about inclusive higher education. But then these are lists of IEP specific support documents for students with ID. So they're all from Think College and they put out wonderful resources. So I would keep these links tucked away, bookmark them so that you can share them with the families that you work with or the educators that you're working with. And then these are some additional resources beyond Think College that we have found helpful. Just some short lists of ways to prepare, how families can start considering some of that funding, all those pieces. So hopefully that doesn't overwhelm you. Hopefully it gives you excitement that there's resources out there. So I'm going to pop this quick link in the chat. Before you guys wrap up for the evening, I would love for you to just fill out this survey for us. It just helps me develop better resources for our community and just hear from you. But I will hang tight. If any of you have questions, I'd love to answer them.